So I'd like you to give a warm welcome to our guests for the evening, John Parrott and Don Stiernberg, everybody.
Thank you. There we go.
Here we go.
Come fly with me, come fly, let's fly away. If you could use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near, and you may hear angels cheer, 'cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day, and just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, come fly, let's fly away. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near, you may hear angels cheer, 'cause we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day, just say the word and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's fly away.
Well, as Joe just said, we're going to give you three quick tunes here, and I promised not to say too much so we can get the tunes in before it's time to visit with Joe. But I will say this, thanks so much for coming in tonight. It's an honor and a pleasure, of course, to be back at Stage Left Cafe with my old friends. It's always good to see old and new friends, and here we are. Ready?
Ready.
One, two, three, four.
When I reach my destination, there's a story I will tell. How a train pulled into town one morning, wasn't riding on the rail. A silver engine drew my imagination, decked in flowers as I recall, and 100 bright red coaches trail behind that cannonball.
And when the train pulled in the station, I didn't see no crying there, only joy, joy and jubilation as she rose up in the air.
As if called to some fine celebration, the people flocked into the street. They gathered round in breathless expectation, as though some long-lost friends they were to meet. Come aboard, you need no reservation. Many heard and many took a seat. Men, women, and children, without hesitation, answered to that call so sweet.
And when the train pulled in the station, I didn't see no crying there, only joy, joy and jubilation as she rose up in the air.
Now had come the hour of separation. Some would travel and some remain. But a promise of reconciliation stayed the tears that might have fallen in vain. She is gone like some fair constellation that has faded with the dawn. How the tale of bright transfiguration, how it lingers and lingers on and on.
And when the train pulled in the station, I didn't see no crying there, only joy, joy and jubilation as she rose up in the air.
We should say at least that was a song written by Kendall Cart, a fellow that we were lucky to share the stage with at a place you may remember, Juicy John Pink's in DeKalb, Illinois. A wonderful guitar player and piano player and songwriter.
Yeah. In fact, hi, Kendall. He's probably tuning in tonight.
Yeah.
I would think, yeah.
Oh, yeah. There we go.
Oh, John's going to switch guitars already. Right. You could see how he abuses the guitars. He's got to have a fresh one right next to him.
Somebody bring a new one out to me every few
songs. Some of our music is done on the flat top guitar, and some is done on the famous arch top guitar. Of course, I just have the mandolin.
Well, it's an arch top instrument, you know. This is a noble instrument that kind of replaced the banjo back in the late 1920s, you know? And I'd like to play a tune now by another fellow, Danny Barker, who was one of the pioneers of the archtop guitar. Played for many years with Cab Calloway, Red Allen, and this is a tune that he wrote called Save the Bones for Henry Jones.
It's a true story, I suppose.
I think so. Yeah. Thank you. Tonight we're gonna have us a party. I mean, it's gonna be a big affair. And at the head of the table, we're gonna place Henry Jones's chair. It's gonna be a big time. We're gonna shout, we're gonna laugh, we're gonna eat. Then we'll scoop up all the bones for Henry Jones, 'cause Henry doesn't eat no meat. I'm going down to the market, the French market, and buy myself a load of fish. That should please old brother Henry, because fish is his favorite dish. And while I'm there, I'll get a big jug of molasses, because Henry likes to have something sweet to eat. Then we'll scoop up all the bones for Henry Jones, 'cause Henry doesn't eat no meat. Now Henry's not a drinker like me. He hardly ever takes a sip. And Henry doesn't need to use a napkin, because the food that Henry eats, it doesn't drip. Last week we had us a party, and I mean, Don, it was a real bake. We started out with short ribs of beef, and we ended up with T-bone steak.
All right.
And after that luscious affair was over, Henry, like a gentleman, came and took his seat. And we scooped up all the bones for Henry Jones, 'cause Henry doesn't need no meat. Pick it there. He's not a boozer like me. He hardly ever takes a sip. And Henry doesn't need a napkin, because the food that Henry eats, it doesn't drip. Why, last week we had ourselves a party. It was a real New Orleans bake. We started out with short ribs of beef, then we ended up with T-bone steak. And after affair was over, Henry, like a gentleman, took his seat. And we scooped up all the bones for Henry Jones. Henry doesn't eat no meat. He likes the gristle. Henry doesn't eat no meat. He's a vegetarian. Henry doesn't eat no meat.
How about that?
Down to Jen, everybody.
Thank you.
Oh, that was great. That was terrific. Now, well, I got a couple questions I want to start out with, but we're going to do a little time traveling tonight, and we'd like to take you back to the early years.
Uh-oh.
Now, if you would think, the internet being what it is, you could find a baby playing a mandolin, but no. Don, do you remember this place?
Oh my goodness.
This
I
is
sure
Camp
do.
Macajuan up in Pearson, Wisconsin. Sound like the right town? It's somewhere up there.
It's near Antigo and Rhinelander.
Yeah, okay. There. Yeah, you remember more of it than I do. Now, you'll see that good looking group there in the middle. None of them are us. At Camp Macajuan, and this was late 60s, right down somewhere around there.
Yes.
Yeah. That was the first taste I had of acoustic music and of essentially folk music. And one of the guys who was pretty instrumental in letting me hear that stuff was this fella here. This is Don's brother, John. John Stiernberg was part of our troupe and played a lot of folk music during our time up there. And I think we were there for what, about 6 months at a time, something like that?
No.
It was 10 months. It was a really long time.
The winters were rough.
It was like Valley Forge, only without the great food. This is a picture that actually I cobbled together from some stuff on John's page here. And I wondered if you guys would kind of tell us a little bit about what we're looking at here. That's John in the middle, John Stiernberg, John Parrott to your left. And under that hat, is that you, Don?
Yes, sir.
It is?
Yes, it is.
So what age were you when you started playing?
Playing the instrument?
Yeah.
I think 15 or 16.
15 or 16. So you're not too far into it in this picture.
No, not at all. I felt really lucky that the two Johns would let me come along and play.
So that's kind of
worth the bus trip.
Now, John, did you and John Stiernberg work together as a duo at all?
Yes, we worked together as a duo pretty regularly for at least a couple of years.
They were hot.
Was it called the Two Johns?
No, we were called, we wanted something catchy, so we called ourselves Parrott and Stiernberg.
And, I think you missed a bet.
Yeah. And we worked for a couple of years. We got jobs in places like the Best Western, the Broughton Brow, and Oshkosh.
Oh, my.
And we, because we played to different audiences, we had to work up repertoire to be able to please different audiences. So we started to dabble in country music. We actually got onto a radio show over in Oshkosh. The Oshkosh Cannonball Opry had us on as a duet from time to time. So we hit the airwaves big sometime around 1970.
That's stunning. I want to move us into the next phase here.
Sure.
So anybody can start in on this one as you want. The one on the left certainly is self-explanatory. That's Morgan Brothers. You were rocking the hairstyle back at that point, and that was before we met our mutual barber that you mentioned.
Right. Yeah, that's real. That's real hair.
I know. Don't you miss it?
Many people are not going to believe that, but.
What's that upper right from? Does anybody remember?
That's the Blue River Cafe, and the band is called Beats Working. That's a post-Morgan Brothers band.
I think in the leftmost picture at Big Al's, which was the best place in town to eat.
And, well, it's a great-looking picture.
That's also our van on the left-hand side, the old Dodge van sitting there by the parking. I just noticed that.
Also point out Charlie Malik, our original bass player.
Yeah, a lot of these folks are they still playing music, do you know? Are they still part of...
I think Charlie plays a little bit from time
Charlie
to time.
Plays up in the Eau Claire area. I don't know what's happened to Jim Driscoll. Ken Finkel and Don Stiernberg play in a great bluegrass band called Third Coast Bluegrass.
Uh-huh.
And I play rhythm guitar wherever they'll have me.
I was starting to say earlier that in that shot under the Big Al sign, by that point I had moved up into Ripon and started school, I'm pretty sure.
Okay.
And right from that year, Morgan Brothers were... a full-time band. We would play as many nights per week as possible. So and we played so much that now when people ask me where'd you go to college, I say I went to Ripon College and I majored in playing bluegrass in bars.
So it was bluegrass strictly at that point then, huh?
Well, yes and no. Bluegrass instruments for sure. And a lot of inspiration from traditional bluegrass, but also we like to screw around with other styles. We take, tunes associated with Django Reinhardt, and we'd pick them on these instruments, or we'd play in a Allman Brothers song, or Eagles songs, things like that. We take music that we liked and see how it would work with the blend that we had.
Now, had you been studying with Jethro at this point?
Yes, indeed.
Jethro certainly was part of Homer and Jethro. Really popular late 50s, early 60s, if I have the time frame right. Speak to maybe that Playing It Straight album a little bit, if you would, in terms of where that hit you.
Well, I can remember the exact place.
Yeah.
I had a job when I was in high school at a factory in Wakanda called TV Labs.
Oh, yeah.
And the radio would play in there. I was playing WJJD, which used to be the country station in this whole area. And they played a track from this record called I Found a New Baby. And that was like the light bulb going off. I said, wait a minute, that's a mandolin player playing jazz. And it was a song that I'd grown up listening to in my father's jazz record collection. And so I heard I Found a New Baby, and that kind of set my direction in life right there. When you can actually play jazz on a mandolin. Let's go, you know.
Off of JJD, no less.
Yeah.
That's pretty strange.
It wasn't like airplay for the record. It was like bumper music. Hey, we'll be right back in a few seconds.
And they weren't even playing the cut? They were using it?
They didn't, and that was Homer and Jethro playing. No, it wasn't even, it was just I think they call it bumper music.
Yeah. After Homer's passing, Jethro was in the Chicago area, right? He was Evanston based at the time, is that
right? That's correct, straight through. Yeah.
And he was playing with a lot of folks. I've thrown a few pictures up of some of the things that are on there, and some of these are in sequence, some of them are out. You're going to recognize Howard Levy down there in the lower left corner. I'd like you to talk about, though, how the beginnings and how the formation of the Jethro Burns Quartet came in. How did he decide that you were going to be part of the band? I guess that applies to both of you guys here.
Well, I'll back up a little bit and then wind up right where your question is.
Sure.
There I was as a high school student taking lessons from Jethro. And at one point or another, my brother and John and myself all got acquainted and started playing together. And one time I asked John, he was in town for some reason, and I said, I got this lesson with Jethro, would you like to come? Oh yeah, I'd definitely like to come. So we went and had kind of a joint lesson with the great one, and John started playing rhythm guitar, and not too long after that, Jethro started to cry. And it was the only time I ever saw him cry, and it was just that one time I ever saw him crying. And we finished the tune, and he starts wiping the tears away, and he looks at John, and he says, sounds just like Homer. And Homer passed, I think, in 72, somewhere in there. And so we were in Jethro's office pretty soon after that. So that was where Jethro got acquainted with John. Yeah. And of course, he was also aware of the Morgan brothers. And he'd let me, when I came home for the holidays from Ripon, he let me come over for a lesson and a conversation and stuff like that. And so we all got better and better acquainted. And fast forward to, I'm not sure what year, but Jethro got a regular gig at Dirty Nellie's in Palatine. And that gig was to host the open stage. And they actually hired him as a comedian, and introduced people who were going to play their own original material.
So he was MC then, as well as musician.
Yeah. Yeah, they basically wanted him there because he would be a great MC and also funny, of course. But Jethro got the idea when he took the gig. He says, I want to play. And he asked John and myself if we would come to those gigs. It was always on a Sunday. And there was a bass player also that got invited in, a fellow named Russ Daughtry. I'm sure some of the folks here might remember Russ. But we started playing. That was the beginning of the Jethro Burns Quartet, answering your question.
At Dirty Nellie's.
Dirty Nellie's. We played, I don't know how many weeks there, every Sunday, but we got a hold of most of Jethro's repertoire as far as the instrumental stuff. He didn't do any comedy, so much as he just played for fun, for himself. He hadn't had that type of an opportunity in that time frame. So all that talk about Homer and Jethro and those very inspirational instrumental records that they made. This is one off of, I think the first one off the
Playing It Straight, yeah.
Yeah. And you'll know this one. It's even older than I am. I want to be happy. It's a true story of my own life.
Don Stiernberg. Yeah.
All right.
I just want to touch briefly on some of the things that came up. Jethro was the sideman with Steve Goodman for quite a while. And remember when that began at all?
Mid-1970s, I'd say, yeah. After Homer had passed and... Jethro was sort of casting around, looking, you know, trying to figure out new things to do. He was kind of retooling his mandolin playing and going out sometimes as a solo act. And Steve Goodman started using him just as in a duet context, and then later in a band context.
Yeah. Story I heard there was that Jethro's son Johnny Burns brought Jethro to the Earl of Old Town, where Goodman had a show,
yeah,
and he said, "I'm real close to the stage." Jethro watched the show and he fell in love with Goodman. It's as simple as that, and he liked him so much. I think he saw himself in, you know, in Goodman. He's a funny guy, great musician,
yeah,
songwriter, etc. So he went up to Jethro at the end of the set and said, "If you ever need a mandolin player, call me." And he called, like. A day or two after that.
I can't believe he didn't chase him out the door that night and ask.
Yeah. He called and he got Gussie, Jethro's wife, on the phone. Jethro wasn't in when he called, and Steve explained to Gussie why he was calling. He says, "I've got a tour coming up on the East Coast. I got a handful of dates. I was wondering if Jethro would like to come along and play." And Gussie says, "You're damn right he wants to play." Says, "You take him. Come over and take him now."
Out of this house.
We got to, when we were playing on that TV special, Jethro and Friends, we got to experience firsthand the brilliance of Steve Goodman. And there's this one event there that has stayed with me all these years. It was just about time for Steve and Jethro to do a little set of their own. And Jethro calls, hey, Steve, now come on, we're going up now, you know. And Steve says, Jethro, just give me this. He's got pen and paper in his hand. He says, can you give me just a couple more minutes? Which that, you know, that's not the way to make Jethro happy, really. But he says, can you just give me a couple more minutes? I'm going to finish this song, and then we'll do it. So that's the point of the story, is I got to see, like at a distance from you to me, Joe, I got to see Steve Goodman write a song, like, instantly, and seemed like a miracle to me. And we'll play that song for you right now.
That's great.
Some people sit in the jacuzzi every night and every day. They think that boiling water will take all their blues away. To be successful is so stressful, so the Hottentots unwind and party, party, party while they're boiling their behinds. But not me. I like my lobsters from the sea. I'm a hermit with a permit to be a hot club refugee. Some people cannot see the danger, so they sit and soak for hours till they're hot tub hypnotized. And they say it's so romantic, and the only way to score is to bathe with 30 people that you never met before. But not me. That's just one place I'll never be. I'm just a hermit with a permit to be a hot club refugee. And then Steve said to Jethro, now soak it to me. Tried the tubs in Aspen where the bunnies go to ski, and the tubs in California full of wet celebrities. But I swear a hot tub party makes my spirit start to droop as I watch the sweet young tomatoes try to turn themselves to soup. But not me. My onions mean too much to me. Saturated, 'cause I'm a hot tub refugee. Hot tub.
A big hand for Dad and John, everybody.
This is a song written by Harry Warren, who later went on to do things like We're in the Money and I Only Have Eyes for You and many other great hits for the musicals with Busby Berkeley. And this is a tune he wrote early on that I think I learned it off the television when I was a little kid.
Yeah.
This is one called September in the Rain. The leaves of brown came tumbling down, remember that September in the rain. The moon went out just like a dying ember that September in the rain. With every word of love I heard you whisper,
The raindrops seem to play a sweet refrain. Though spring is here, to me it's still September. That September in the rain. Of brown came tumbling down. Remember that September in the rain. The moon went out just like a dying ember. That September in the rain. With every word of love I heard you whisper, the raindrops seem to play a sweet refrain. Though spring is here, to me it's still September. That September in the rain.
John picked that song out when I told him the date of the gig. When do we play in Woodstock again? September 7th. Oh, I'll do September in the rain. Thank goodness it's not raining now, is it?
No, and the leaves don't really fall in September too much either, but, you know.
Poetic license. Poetic
license. Or he lived in Edmonton or something.
We're going to ask you to sing along with us. You know it. Just join in on the choruses. Let us pause in life's pleasures and count its many tears while we all sup sorrow with the poor. There's a song that will linger forever in our ears. Oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis a song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. While we seek mirth and beauty and music light and gay, there are frail forms fainting at the door. Though their voices are silent, their pleading looks will say, oh, hard times come again no more. 'Tis the song, the sigh of
the weary. Hard times, hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. There's a pale weeping maiden who toils her life away with a warm heart whose better days are old. Though her voice would be merry, a sighing all the day. Oh, hard times come again no more. Song, the sigh of the weary. Hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more. Many days you have lingered around my cabin door. Oh, hard times come again no more.
Well, you know, we like to be fair in our duet, so it's, now it's time for John to sing a number. See how I did that?
Yeah.
And
shifted this.
You've been hearing in this set, you know, a lot of our various influences, songs, artists, and so on. And the next one of those is the great Jimmy Rogers. He's not only called the singing brakeman, I think I've read about him being the father of country music. One of America's first superstars, John, did you know that?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. RCA. I mean,
he sold millions and millions of records.
Yeah.
Back when million was a new word.
Yeah.
You know? He was like the Michael Jackson or, you know, Madonna or something like that in his time. And John's got this great Jimmy Rogers song that he'll sing. We'll pick a little bit, and then we'll turn things back over to Joe. So thank you, folks. Here's John to sing Jimmy's Texas Blues.
The way I feel, sometimes I wish I were dead. The way I feel, sometimes I wish I were dead. I ain't got no place to lay my weary head. Every time I want you, I always find you gone. Every time I want you, I always find you gone. Slow down, pretty mama, don't put your hair brakes on. You've been having your troubles, I've had my troubles too. You've been having your troubles, I had my troubles too. Yes, I know what it's like when you feel so doggone blue. Singing the blues, I'm just telling you the hard luck I had.
Oh, I've had it.
I'm not singing the blues, I'm just telling you the hard luck I had. Cause the blues ain't nothing but a good man feeling bad. Thank you.
like Chicago, some like old Memphis, Tennessee. Some folks like Chicago, some like old Memphis, Tennessee. Give me sweet Dallas, Texas, where the women think the world of me.
We're gonna yodel now.
John Parrott right there. How about it? Thank you, folks.
Don and John, everybody. That was wonderful. We're gonna try to go through some of your questions, some of your requests. And one of the requests we had was something akin to the national anthem, or what used to be the national anthem. Don, if you would do the honors.
Sure.
Woo.
Yeah.
That was great. That was great. Did you guys play sports in school? John?
Tennis?
Yeah. How about grade school, though, earlier? Did you play tennis that early?
Tennis. Ping pong.
Ping pong. How about you, Don?
I played sports up until I met Jethro.
Is that right?
And then I tried to play the mandolin instead, yeah. But Yeah, you don't want me to start talking about my sports career.
Well, I mean, I do.
I did set a lot of records, you know, especially on the baseball team. I made the sophomore team, kind of high school, and I set some records there, like most strikeouts by a batter.
in a single inning.
But yeah, it was baseball and basketball for me. Like I say, seriously, right up until the time when I got real excited about being a mandolin player.
Maybe you folks don't know, but Don plays a heck of a lot of guitar. We see him all the time with a mandolin, but we had one of the albums that up on the board here bouncing around during the breaks that you did with Megan McDonough back in the early 2000s. And if you haven't had a chance to listen to that, please seek it out someplace. It's Don playing guitar with Megan doing vocals. And the whole album is Don on guitar. So if you want a real opportunity, and I
got to ask, is that the Patsy Cline record?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, the Patsy Cline.
It's a wonderful record. I second his recommendation.
Don is one of the great collaborators. And I wish you would talk to us a little bit about how all of these different groups came into being. John mentioned one of the ones you're in currently. How do these collaborations come around for you?
Well, I don't mean this to sound the way it's going to sound, but basically the phone rings, you know. Or maybe I'll perform with somebody at a festival. This happened, it comes to mind because one of the bands I play with pretty regularly, this is what happened. We were appearing at the same festival, and at the end of the set, a person came up to me and said, "Hey, we do a regular night in Rogers Park, and why don't you come down? You don't live very far away." Next thing I know, I've been going there every week for like 6 years, you know. So it happens like that sometimes.
John, you got a similar thing up north?
Oh, yeah, we do. We do. We have we get little groups of people together, and there'll be a cafe or a pizza parlor or something that has a patio, and we'll bring some music stands, and somebody will just throw some music on the stand, and, you know, 45 minutes later, we've played a set. Who knows how it happened? We all had a ball. We all learned something.
When you do arrangements, where do you like to start? John, do you arrange, don't you?
He writes great tunes.
I write tunes, and I try and arrange them, and I play them in a... We play them in a little band up in Milwaukee with Chris Hansen and the great singer Robin Plure. And a lot of the things that I do are instrumentals, but some of them are also words. And I just, it's one of those things that I just enjoy creating. I do it kind of on my lonesome. I get some input from the band, and we figure out an arrangement, and they come up with ideas that I wouldn't have thought of otherwise. And it's really, you know, been a wonderful thing for me, and it's been an outlet that is terrific.
Well, there's a particular question in here about your collaboration with Robbie Foulkes down at at the Hideout down there.
Mm-hmm.
And how did that come into being?
Well, there it is. Robbie is a really old friend, going back to when he started playing music professionally with the Special Consensus. That was what brought him to Chicago, where he ended up living for 25 or so years.
Yeah.
So we were kind of bluegrass friends, let's put it that way, since when he first came to town. He was a kid, you know, quite honestly. But then as the years went on, he might need a mandolin part on a record he was making or something. He called me up. And then we discovered that he lived only one exit away from me. Like, I'm in Skokie, and he used to be in Northfield.
Yeah.
And I think maybe a light bulb went off, you know, like, oh, if I need somebody on such and such a gig, I'll just pick them up on the way, you know. We live real close. But also, you know, to your question, there's a mutual respect there and a really good feeling. You know, I consider Robbie to be one of the best at what he does, if not the best. So I'm thrilled every time he calls. I scratch stuff out so I can do his gig.
I have chased Don around the country, bugging him about an updated version of Homer and Jethro with Don and Robbie Foulkes. So I'll do it again now. Next time he's in town, ask him about it. We've got a question from Scott B. in the audience, and I've been really reluctant to unleash this beast here, but besides Harry Carey, does Don do any other impersonations?
You know, you gotta wonder. Here's the man, racing for home. Crafty left-hander now, Joe Pesz. In the stretch, now ready. Pitch. He hits a line drive. It might be fair, and it might be foul. And it is.
Now, I gotta say, the first time I heard Don do this, we were playing over at Mast House, which is just down the street from here. I had never heard him do Harry Carey. We're working with a mutual friend of ours by the name of Dan Zion. Hi, Dan.
Yeah, Dan.
Had an interesting experience. I worked with Dan Zion for a number of years, And Don had done some recordings with Jethro that he took to the West Coast to have Acoustic Disc put them out. Now, Acoustic Disc is David Grisman's label, if I understand correctly.
That's correct.
And Don had just come back from this, taking this first trip out there, and he finds himself going from a real high to a real, what seemed to be a real low. Do you remember that little trip we took, the three of us, out after you'd come back from that first West Coast trip?
Out by the river? Near Iowa?
Yeah.
Was that it?
That was it.
Yeah, well, that was no low. That was a blast.
Well, it was a blast, but hadn't you just played someplace really big time prior to finding yourself in the band, like maybe the Cow Palace that night or the Fillmore out there with David Grisman?
Oh, there was the Great American Music Hall.
Great American Music Hall.
Yeah.
How do you navigate the highs and the lows in this this kind of life?
There's not even close to enough time to describe that to you. No, it's... I've been... I always say on stage, I'm the luckiest man in the world, and one part of that is I've been lucky enough to encounter role models who helped me with that very situation, you know.
Yeah.
Helped me to understand it, and you know, I thank God for running into friends and heroes of mine who would take the time to straighten me out, because it does. It can be a challenge for sure. Like one night you're playing at a mandolin convention, you know, and if you hit enough good notes, everybody claps and everything. And the next day, come back home, and maybe the gig is in the back of a grocery store at 6:30 a.m. by the dairy products, like that, and you're playing your heart out for the shoppers coming by, and the response you get then isn't a round of applause, but rather somebody comes up and says, do you know where the cheese is? You know. So that kind of contrast does happen. It happens to this day.
Well, and I wanted to ask you, in the first set, as we were talking about the Jethro years, did you guys learn the ropes through that... that experience with him, or was there...
Do you mean the experience of the highs and lows of the music business?
Well, or just, yeah, I guess the ropes in general.
I think the thing, at least speaking for myself, what I learned from Jethro Burns was an appreciation of the fun that you can have playing music and being on stage. That it's, yes, it's serious. You have to know your chords. You have to have something kind of set up. But once you get up there... it's not all, you just have to enjoy yourself. And he was just a master at getting us to do that up there on the stage, wouldn't you say, Don? With
yes.
A lot of the times we were having difficulty containing ourselves from laughing right. with him up
yeah.
there. And we had to learn how to do that.
Yeah.
And then he would sometimes use us as a foil. Yeah. You know, he'd say something like to me, like if I started to tell a joke or something like that, he says, John Parrott, he wants his own show. The John Parrott Show, he comes out in a cage. And then you never open your mouth again on stage with Jethro Burns, right? So those are the kinds of things that you learn. It's not quite as, I guess, meditative a process as you're fishing for there, but...
No, well, I don't know that I was fishing for it, but sure, I take your point. So let's keep playing a couple tunes here. We got a request here from a Miss Kate M. out there in Zoomland. Now, you mentioned some stuff about the archtop earlier. Is an archtop guitar a good guitar to play Stars Fell on Alabama?
Oh, it's the best. It's the only one.
You can't play it on any other kind of guitar.
I'm thinking if you guys would.
Sure.
We left our little drama. We kissed in a field of white, and stars fell on Alabama last night. Oh, last night. I can't forget the glamour. Your eyes held a tender light, and stars fell on Alabama last night. I never dreamed in my imagination a situation so heavenly, a fairyland where no one else would enter, you in the center, just being you. My heart beat like a hammer. Your arms wound around me tight, and stars fell on Alabama last night. And I never dreamed in my imagination a situation so heavenly, a fairyland where no one else would enter, and you in the center, just you and me. My heart beat like a hammer. Your arms wound around me tight, and stars fell on Alabama, baby, last night, oh, last night.
Thank you. There's that hopeless romantic thing I was talking about. So we're getting ready to wrap up. I sure hope you guys have had a good time tonight. I've had a wonderful time. We're gonna do two last things here. We've got one final song that is a request, but it's a request from me. And we're gonna pick the winner of this lovely, lovely, genuine, authentic replica of a 47 Cubs hat.
They didn't make them in 1947. They did not make them with the one size fits all strap, Joe. I don't mean to. Nothing against the hat.
Let me see. Who can I get who's an impartial? Ken, you look pretty impartial. Let's. And the winner is Mary Sherman.
Yeah.
Request for the evening is Old Fashioned Love.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. So, if you would, a big hand for these guys as they play us out for the evening. Thanks to everybody at home for joining us. We'll see you again real soon. But one more tune from the guys.
Okay, John?
Yeah.
That's the fifth fret for the D. Oh. Yeah, there it is.
Five.
Got that old-fashioned love in my heart, and there it will always remain. like an ivy clinging vine, clinging closer all the time, through the years and the tears, just the same. I got that old-fashioned faith in my heart, and nothing can tear us apart. Dry land can turn to sea, but there'll be no change in me. Got that old-fashioned love in my heart. Clinging closer all the time, through the years and the tears, just the same. I got that old-fashioned faith in my heart. Nothing will tear us apart. Dry land will turn to sea, but there'll be no change in me. Got that old-fashioned love in my heart. Dry land will turn to sea, but there'll be no change in me. I got that old-fashioned love in my heart.
Thank you, folks.
Yeah, man. Don Stiernberg, Jan Parrott, everybody. Thank you, guys.